Welcome, friends, to this final session of our three-day event in MtLaurel here in New Jersey. And as we conclude this session, I do hope that you found it useful and that you will be able to apply some of the things you heard today and yesterday and day before to your own spiritual life and to your own spiritual progress. Make this spiritual knowledge a practical knowledge, one that applies to every aspect of your life. Spirituality is not at 3 a.m., starting at 3 a.m. and ending at 5:30 a.m. Spirituality is 24/7. You want to be on a spiritual path, you have to be on the spiritual path 24/7. You have to make your life as if it is a mission, that you have got a human life, and the purpose of human life is to take full advantage of the opportunity you have, not lose a single moment into anything that is non-spiritual. Make all your daily activities spiritual. The easiest way to make things spiritual is to repeat the mantra, the simran, the words a master gives you at initiation to repeat, which can be done at any time and all the time. Somebody asked, "Great Master, Master, I am doing 2.5 hour meditation every day. I don't seem to be making any progress." Great Master said, "Out of 24 hours, you only give 2.5 hours to spirituality and 21.5 hours to other things. How can you make progress? It's totally imbalanced. There should be some balance between worldly things and spirituality. But you are totally imbalanced. 2.5 hours to meditation and spirituality and 21.5 hours to sleeping, eating and doing worldly things." He said, "But Master, I am a human being. I have responsibility. I have got a family. I have to take care of my family. I have a job. I have to go and take care of my job. And I can't find even 2.5 hours. It's with great difficulty. I have to watch my clock over and over again. When I'm meditating, it looks 2.5 hours is over. When I look at the timepiece next to me, it's 10 minutes. Then I sit again and force myself. Then after a while, I said, now it must be 2.5 hours. I open my eyes, another 10 minutes. I struggle to make 2.5 hours. You are talking of more than 2.5 hours. Great Master said, "I am talking of 21.5 hours of meditation. Not 2.5 hours, not 3.5 hours, not 8.5 hours. I am talking of 21.5 hours of meditation. And then if you are able to do 2.5 hours of things that are requiring your attention other places, requiring deep attention, where you cannot remember meditation, not more than 2.5 hours. He said, "Master, how is that possible?" He said, "Very easy. When you are doing your normal work, keep on doing simran. If you are a housewife, you do cooking. Keep on doing simran while you are cooking. Remember the master, remember God, remember your names, remember the words. Everything that you do while you are doing that is meditation." Supposing you have been given an assignment, a project, something to do, think it is a master's project. Say, "Master, I'm doing your project." It becomes meditation. If you are able to put everything in that context, what is the purpose of that? That every time you do anything, you remember the master. It's as good as meditation. If you do this during the daytime and you meditate by closing your eyes about 1/2 hour before going to sleep, your meditation will continue even in the 7 or 8 hours of sleep. And then in that case, you will be meditating 21.5 hours. And yet you will do all the worldly work that you have to do. You will be able to fulfill your responsibilities to your family and your children. You will be able to fulfill your responsibilities to your job. And you still be doing meditation. Explain, spiritual life is different. Spiritual life turns our attention away. We do our work for 10% of our attention. It doesn't need more. there is a mind that thinks thoughts that we can read and hear, and there's a mind behind it that we can't hear and read, but very alert. Great Master gave an example. When a lady is cooking her food in the kitchen, and a little child, a toddler, is toddling away in the other room, is far away, her attention is on the food. The forward mind is on the food. If there's a little cry from the child, she can hear it and run there. This is how you should work. You should use your forward mind in what you have to do. Your job, you're taking care of your family, you're taking care of other things, taking care of cooking, working, whatever you do. And Nijman, which he called the Nijman, the inner mind. The inner mind should be on the master and on your spiritual purpose. There's an outer mind, which is the mind that is working, which you are using to work. There's a Nijman, the inner mind. The inner mind should always be thinking of that. It's not difficult. Just start practicing by whatever happens. Say, thank you, Master. I tell you the best way to inculcate a habit of remembering Master is to thank him for what happens. But supposing something bad happens, can you thank him for that? Yes, I think so. By saying, thank God it was not worse. Thank you, Master. Because whatever happens into our lives, there is something worse that could have happened. You all know that. We all know that. Therefore, when you say, thank you, Master. Thank you, it was not that bad. Master, I had an accident. But for you, I would have been killed. I know you saved me. Thank you. You're not thanking him. Why did you take me into an accident? You could also say that. Master, I hate you. You couldn't protect me from this accident. You could say that also. By the way, if you say that, that's also meditation. We're still talking to Master. The beauty is, if you start associating your Master and your Simran with every activity, which you can, whether you are angry or you are happy, it becomes meditation. That is the secret of love and devotion. People say, how can we develop love and devotion? Follow this simple principle. Follow the simple rules and love and devotion comes automatically. Then associate with the Master as much as you can. As much as you can afford. Because Master is a human being. He's a human being come just like ourselves. He's a human being who has job to do. He's a human being who earns his own living. He doesn't depend upon the donations given by his disciples. He earns his own living. A perfect living Master has never lived on donations of anybody. He leads a life just like anybody else. I learned this from him, that no matter how much work I do for Master and his seva, how many people I come and help there in any way, whatever they want, there's never any charge. Nobody can pay me for anything that I do which has got a spiritual touch in it. I gave some talks at a university. In the midst of the talk, where I was being paid, it was not a talk on spirituality, a talk on a scientific subject. The middle, somebody asked me a question which was spiritual. I answered and declined the fee for the whole lecture. I said, sorry, it turned spiritual in the middle. I cannot charge anything for any seva I can do spiritually. Therefore, Master's work. I am doing my business. I have an office. At age 88, I'm still working. I have to take care of my family. I have to take care of my children and grandchildren. They sometimes want help from me. I work. People tell me, why are you working? I said, because I have a very expensive wife. She wants a big bungalow. I am used to living. I had such a small quarter in the Dera. I had a little house. This was a house, like a double story. The upper one had a small little room. My father actually built it in the Dera. It was so small. When I took my friends to show me where I meditated, they were shocked. They went and saw only one small cot could fit in. If I slept, I slept wall to wall. And then on top, there were cobwebs. And then there were some lizards. Some of my American friends wouldn't go in. The lizard will fall on them. I said, I have not only slept, I have meditated very comfortably. I have never noticed these animals around me. He said, how could you do that? Didn't they frighten you? I said, fright only comes when you are afraid of them. You are afraid of them, what will happen? If you don't think of what will happen, you are never afraid. Do you know, all fear comes from what will happen, not what has happened. What happened, what has happened gives you strength to meet it, makes you know what to do. These experiments have been conducted about fear. That people were taken into a forest, there's an animal here roaming, they're afraid. We don't know where he is, where will he attack us. When the animal comes in front, fear goes away, is replaced by another emotion. How to escape, how to meet it, how to beat it, not fear. Fear is of the unknown. And that's why when you don't know, you are afraid. So you could look at, I looked at those creatures. I said, so wonderful. You are living in the era. You'll all be human beings next time. I am so happy to see you. Futures of families. Looked upon them so differently. And had sound sleep. Woke up early. Little room. I must tell you today, I don't need more than the little room ever again or ever since that time. So why am I living in a big house? Old karma. We have to pay our karma. So that is why I still work. It's okay. I enjoy it. I love it. So that is why, but everything I do, no matter what, I give the credit and the debit to Great Master. Something, somebody tells me, praises me. I say, Master, did you hear that? That was for you. Somebody criticizes me. Master, that's for you too. Somebody told me once, a good wise man advised me, you should give all the credit to Master and take the debit to yourself. I said, I'll be ruined that way. We have to be fair. If Master says he takes all responsibility, then he must accept both. Whatever happens, Great Master is willing to do that. All perfect living masters who initiate us are willing to do that. That's part of the deal. It's called a deal. Initiation is a very big deal. In initiation, you are getting security from an enlightened, realized man whose enlightenment goes right up to the top. Therefore, because it goes to the top, he doesn't speak to us from any prior experience. He talks to us from contemporary experience, from what he's having when he's talking to us. It's a very big, different experience. When he initiates us, he takes responsibility for everything, outer and inner. It's not only one side. It's not a perfect living master. It's not a teacher who says, I'm teaching you the method, now go and find out. He's not a person who says, I am a guide of yours, I'll give you guidance, that's the route, go. Not at all. He says, I'll take you with me. I go there all the time. I know the entire route and I'll take you myself. That's perfect living master. It's a totally different relationship. But somehow, I didn't fully believe this relationship. Till one day, another amazing incident happened. I heard a discourse by Great Master. And in that, there was a verse taken from the spiritual book. And the verse was Indian language, then translated for you. The verse that came up was, Kaya Nagar, Nagar hai Niko, which is Sauda Ar Ras Gije. The translation, this body is like a city. This city has a marketplace. You want to have a real deal, go to that marketplace. Hell, good verse. I was in those ambitious days when I said, that's the thing to do. I didn't know how to go to the marketplace. I said, why not go to the chief salesman of that marketplace, Great Master. I went to him. I said, Master, I heard you say in the satsang on that verse that the master makes a deal with the disciple. If you come to the marketplace, you get a deal. I said, Master, does a deal mean a transaction where I give you something and you give me something? That's true. That's a deal. I said, Master, I want to give you all my sorrows, all my sufferings, all my pains, everything you take, all the goodies, all the nice things you give me. He said, done. That's a long time back when this happened. From that time till today, he's kept his word, I've kept mine. The deal worked. I came to the United States, and in my bravado, I happened to share this deal with some friends, Satsangi friends. They criticized me so badly. They said, you were so unfair to your master. You put all your problems to the master and took off all the goodies. What kind of unfair business did you do with him? I was shocked. I said, they have no idea what a master is. What might be the whole world for me with a drop of grace from the master. It didn't cost him even a drop of grace to give me that. He could give the entire humanity that grace with one drop of his nectar inside. People have no idea of a master. A perfect living master has access to that which controls all creation. And that is, we are worried about why that man I talked to. I was not talking to the man. I was talking to the great master. And it says that if you go to the great master and want to have a deal, he'll give you the deal. Provided you follow what you promise, he follows what he promised. Some people tried the deal here after that. They said, we want to try, that's a very good deal. So they said, Pastor, we give you all the worries, and you give us all the goodies. Master said, done. They said, they went home worried whether the deal will work or not. It's so difficult. It looks so easy. The deal looks so easy. Master's job is very easy. He can take over everything, all the problems. Our part is difficult to give the worries to him. We worry over everything. We worry over worry. We worry why we are worried. One person told me, my biggest problem is that I don't worry. I said, that's not a problem. That's a solution. If you don't worry. He said, no, but now I'm worrying. Why I'm not worrying? What kind of thing is this? Our mind is such, it's not easy. It looks like a very easy deal. It's not an easy deal. Our mind doesn't give up. When you reach the stage that your mind can accept this, it's a stage when you have unshakable faith in the Master. When you have unshakable faith, you know who he is, you find out who he is, and then you know who he is, he can have the deal. The deal works. So there's a stage in our life, in our spiritual growth, that comes when you can have a deal like that and have a good life here, hereafter, inside, outside. That is why one of my friends used to say, to come to the spiritual path and have a deal is like heaven on earth. It's heaven over here. You don't have to go to heaven for that. It's a heavenly experience right here on earth. You can make it a heavenly experience if everything that happens is taken care of by Master. And you can watch it. What is supposed to be our role as spiritual seekers and spiritual co-travelers? As I said, I am a co-traveler with you. That's why I'm sharing all this. As a spiritual traveler on this path, we have to watch this life and the body going through this life like a show. There was a friend of mine, an American surgeon, Dr. Julian Johnson. Some of you might have read his books, Path of the Masters and other books. He came to India and he was a very good follower, very great follower. When he came to India, he was a Christian missionary. He was converting people to Christianity. He was working in Calcutta, in India. And he heard from some couple, Mr. and Mrs. Brock, in the United States, that there is a master in India. He lives in a little village on the bank of the river Bias in Punjab. And you should go and meet him. He was curious to meet him. But then when he heard more stories of how people are able to give up their life and change their life by meeting a perfect living master, he had never heard of that before. So he decided to go and meet the master. He wrote to the master from Calcutta that I want to come and see you because I've heard about you from my friends and want to know what I can get from you. Master wrote back, come by a train that comes from Calcutta to Amritsar. It's called the Calcutta Mail. It does not stop where I live. It does not stop at a station called Bias. You can either stop 25 miles earlier at Jalandhar or 25 miles later in Amritsar. We'll pick you up. Since Jalandhar comes first, it'll be more convenient for you to get down at Jalandhar. Secondly, a very close friend of mine, an attorney, an English-speaking attorney, lives just next to the railroad station in Jalandhar. And you let us know which train you are coming, he'll come to the station and pick you up. Master letter went to him. He boarded the train. And while he's in the train, Master says to Bhagat Singh, let's play a trick on him. Could you imagine a master trying to play a trick on a newcomer like that? I think he was very mischievous that way. He was. I saw many times. He said, let's play a trick on this man, this American missionary that is coming. He is expecting, he is in great anxiety to meet me. He's anxious to meet me. And when he comes and lands there, you go, Bhagat Singh, and receive him there. But meanwhile, I'll drive from Dera and sit in your house and hide there. When he comes, say, come and have a cup of tea with me. You had a long, tiring journey. And he will say, no, I am in a hurry to meet the master. You say, what's the hurry about it? Now that you have come, I'll take you home. He'll get angry with you. And once he's angry, that's the time to force him and bring him home. And when you bring him home and his face will be angry and he will not be unhappy, he says, Dr. Johnson, I have a surprise for you. Then you bring him into the living room and he'll meet me. It'll be sort of a contrast. They create a contrast. We live in the world of pairs of opposites. That's exactly what happened. Julian Johnson, first time, arrives in Jalandhar. Bhagat Singh, the attorney, goes to the through the railroad station, and there only one white American was coming out of the train, so he knew that's Johnson. He said, Dr. Johnson, welcome. I have come, I'm Bhagat Singh. I'm sent by great master to receive you and take you to the Dera. But before you go to the Dera, I want to take you home to give you a cup of tea. It was a very long journey. And he said, No, I'm not interested in tea. I'm not interested in going anywhere. I just want to go straight to the master and see him. He said, what's the hurry? You are so tired. He said, no, don't irritate me. I have not come here for tea. I come from the United States of America. And I'm doing very important work in Calcutta. And I don't want to go into tea and all these things. I've not come for any social activity. He says, come on, doctor. You might be an American, but Indian custom is to treat people with a cup of tea and some sweets I've kept for you. No, I don't want to go. And he took him by force to his house. And there he says in the house, Dr. Johnson, I have a surprise for you. And he brings him into the living room. And great master sitting there, he says, welcome, Julian Johnson. First reaction, stunned. At first words he spoke, Master, you came over here to see me? Master says, you traveled thousands of miles to come and see me. I only traveled 25 miles to come and see you. Come, welcome, sit with me. He sat there, he didn't know what to talk. The surprise itself was overwhelming him. He sat there looking at Master. Just looking at him and wondering, what kind of a person is he? Why do I call him Master? What is radiating from him? What's happening to me? Later he went with great master to the Dera and typed out a letter to his friends and family back in the United States. I saw a copy of that letter. He wrote, I have just arrived today and great master played a trick on me. And I thought I will see him in the Dera. He himself traveled all the way to the city where the train stopped and brought me home. And when the attorney took me to his house, I was so surprised, amazed, I looked at as if God was sitting in front of me. I only spent 2 hours in his presence. If I get nothing more, I'm satisfied with my visit. If my spiritual seeking has been completed, even if I get nothing more than this. That's the first letter he wrote. Afterwards, he meditated a lot, as much as he could, because he said, this is my whole time job now, to test out what this spiritual path is, what this source of yoga is, what this yoga of audible sound current is. So he saw that there were a lot of people socializing around in the Dera and just having a good time, chatting away. He didn't want to waste time. After a few months, he decided to see where are the people, real seekers who are meditating, and he found there were some sadhus. Some people come exclusively for meditational purposes, and they had dug their caves on the bluff of the river Vyas. He went and dug his own cave and made his meditation cave on the bank of the river, about a mile away from the Dera. And he would go and meditate 8 hours, 10 hours at a time. He got so many experiences which he wouldn't share with anybody. Great Master told him, you can share with some people. Out of those some people, the fortunate one was me, because I was very small and I spoke English. And we could communicate, so I would go with him to the cave also, to his cave. He shared pretty soon, a few months later, an experience where he saw his past lives. One life, second, third, back to the Stone Age, where he was a caveman and he almost killed his son, who was disobedient, by throwing him, by knocking him on a stone and throwing him in a well. The last moment he didn't do it, but the intention created a lot of karma for him later on. And he saw all that. To be able to see his past lives like that was a very big, first big experience for him. Then he began to have experience of higher levels of awareness. And as he went through these things, he became a good friend of mine. And we would share this information. I was also having some little stories to tell him, which he listened to intently. But when he would walk there, he would tell me, after I think 1 or 2 years of being in the Dera, one day he said to me, you know, I have been complaining to Master about certain things, about karma of people. I have been requesting and praying to him, please help my friend who is sick now in America. I have been praying to him, please help that person who couldn't succeed in life. What was I doing? I now realizing, I am realizing that this human life with sickness and health, human life with poverty and riches, this human life with ups and downs, is a package, a platter of opportunities for us. Those are insignificant things. And I was always thinking, these are the important things of life. These ups and downs are necessary to make human life. If there was all good times, we would not be here. We would be in heaven. All bad times, we would be in hell, not here. To be in this physical plane, where we can get a physical body and make use of it, is only possible here. I am never going to tell Master about anything that involves only physical desires, physical problems, because they are part of life. I say, he told me, that a platter of fortune has been given to us with the ups and downs. And that's what I've realized. I entirely agreed with him that we are looking upon life as the only reality, and we are talking of little problems that come here and magnify them so much, forgetting that those are the very problems when we can think of God, we can think of the spiritual things. We don't think of spiritual things and God when we are having good time. It's the bad times when we think of them. How can we call them bad? If the spiritual path consists of remembering God, remembering the Master, how can we call those times bad? And that's why after that he discovered that this is not something we should pay attention, we should be grateful. And then how do you practice gratitude? As I said earlier, Good happens, thank you. Bad happens, could have been worse. Too bad happens, sorry, but accept it. Because when there is a balance, if the balance goes too low one place, it will go too high on the other place, which is also true in life. If you see, when you dip too low, you also go high. It's a sine curve. So that's why everything is worth gratitude. Now, if you practice gratitude, you're on the spiritual path. If you express gratitude and remember Master all the time, it'll be a meditation for 21 and a half hours. That's what spiritual life should be. If you are not willing to do that, if that's not your intention to do that, then you are on the periphery of a spiritual experience. Then you can feel good sometimes, feel bad, some doubt sometimes. That's an ordinary life. It's not a spiritual life. A spiritual life is when you are high and up with the memory of Master all the time. So that's why I recommend, you are all my co-travelers. You are traveling with me in the same path. And we are going to have a good time. The best time you can have is on this co-travel, on this path, spiritual path. Travel of every kind. Therefore, make your life a spiritual life by following the simple tips. And one more tip I want to give you, and that is about when I say in meditation, you contemplate the form of the Master and talk to him. That contemplation on the face of the Master should not be on a photograph, should not be on a picture. It should be from live memory of having seen the Master. Earlier a question was asked, how can you love a Master if you have never seen him? My answer was a straight no, you can't. And I still say that. You can't love anybody if you have never seen. You can make pictures of him and rattle in your own mind, I have got these feelings for you. It's all your own mind game. These mind games never equate with love, because mind games come from the mind, love comes from the soul. They can never equate each other. But if you are beginning to have that devotion and love for a Master, and you recall when you saw the Master, how you saw him, where was it, and bring that memory, and bring the Master from the memory, and the Master begins to talk further than what was heard in the memory, you are in good dhyan, contemplation of the Master. That's how that part of meditation should be done. The entire meditation should be done by bringing Master into it. That's why they say, if you have been initiated into this path following the course of repeating words, Simran, and thereafter listen to the sound that you can hear, which you can or we cannot hear sometimes, you have to wait. If you can hear, hear the sound. And third part is contemplation of the face of the Master, which is dhyan. Dhyan overlaps. Both. Dhyan is not an independent thing. It's not that you do one, then two, then dhyan. Dhyan comes both on Simran and on listening to the sound. Do it in the presence of the Master. See him inside. I am saying this because I have been hearing for years now stories of why people don't make progress on the spiritual path. I am giving you very practical tips how you make progress on the spiritual path. So I am very happy I shared this experience with you in these last 2 days, and now comes the time when I want to give you, for those who are desirous of it, some blessed food.